The mighty and resilient Merrimack River, carving through the communities of our great region. My name is Linda Lorden, proud president of Merrimack County Savings Bank. And like the river that serves as our namesake, we're a constant yet ever-changing presence. Because to us, it's bigger than banking. It's about powering communities and putting people first. It's about knowing where you came from and where you're going. That's Merrimack style. Visit us at themerrimack.com.
Hi, my name is Govind Jayaraman, and welcome to Paper Napkin Wisdom. I'm thrilled to have you here today because I'm going to introduce you to somebody who is a very influential person. He's now a coach to many entrepreneurs across the United States. He's literally done 350 days of in-house consultation with a number of businesses, and it's truly impactful. He himself is an entrepreneur and has sold his company as recently as 2011 to focus more fully on his coaching. He has been actively involved in his community, and I think really one of the really refreshing things about Andy is just his directness, the directness of his approach. He's no nonsense, and it motivates people at a very basic level to step up and execute within every organization that he's ever worked with. Let's listen into my conversation with Andy Bailey. Great pleasure to be sitting here with my good friend Andy Bailey. Andy Bailey and I met through the Entrepreneurs Organization a little while ago, and he's a really fun, really direct guy who gets to the bottom of it every time, right? Bottom of the fun right away, yeah. The bottom of the problem right away, the bottom of the trouble. But you're great at distilling stuff. And Andy, thanks for joining me on Paper Napkin Wisdom.
You bet, man. I love the concept and love the idea.
Thanks, man. And I know you tell me otherwise, so that's why I can thank you for that. So the whole vision here is to just have these nuggets of wisdom, and I've really enjoyed and had takeaway from our conversations, and I love your paper napkin wisdom. So there are two parts to it. There's you're drawing a line on it, and the first half is WTF. Now, for those of you listening, everybody knows what WTF means, but what you're saying is you think you do, but you're saying where's the focus? So why did you share that with me?
Yeah, so we actually make these little wristbands. People wear them, whatever. And it says W2F, where's the focus on it? And people wear them around. And we've had stories of little old ladies coming up to people in the grocery store and saying, oh, my God, I can't believe you have that on your wrist. And they'll say back to them, well, it's not what I think it is. It's what you think it is. So, focus is just something that's so, so hard to get these days. And something that more and more entrepreneurs and individuals in any business need to go find. I'm sure you have trouble with that yourself, right, Bilvin?
Absolutely.
We do, focus and finding what's important every single day. And too many people in businesses, they don't set clear goals or priorities, which makes it very, very difficult to focus.
So, when you talk about where the focus is this something that, that you've always done, you've always been really highly focused, or did you learn to get focused?
I think about 18 years of entrepreneurship beat it into me, right?
Yeah.
So finding ways to set priorities long-term and break them down into short-term tasks and then keep those tasks in front of me for short periods of time every single day so that I can look back at the end of the day and say, that was a good day. So for me, I think it has been a learned set of skills and something that we help other people do all the time.
Yeah, so I know that when you guys are doing workshops with companies through PetroCoach, this lack of focus in leadership is a theme. It's a recurring theme, right? It's something that you see all the time.
Yeah, too many businesses either don't have a focus by setting these priorities with a very, very clear vision, or they just set too many of them. They feel like we can do you know, 50 things are on our list when we can really only do 3 to 5 at a time, or focus on 3 to 5 at a time. Jim Collins will tell you, if you got more than one, you got too many. So, you know, narrowing that list down to a very small number is a very, very good practice. Another thing that we found to be very, very helpful is making the goals SMART, so specific, measurable, attainable, relevant, and time-bound. So the time-bound piece is, I'm going to achieve this by this particular date. The specific and the measurable side can be more difficult. When I say specific, somebody like may make a goal out of, hey, I'm going to lose 10 pounds. Well, sure, that's a goal, but you want to break that down into something that you can measure as well with KPIs or key performance indicators. So if your goal is to lose 10 pounds, your key performance indicator may be, I'm going to the gym 4 days a week for 4 hours per week. And if there's 13 weeks in the quarter, then you just measure the number of hours you're in the gym as opposed to measuring the pounds. So your performance indicator is the time spent at the gym doing these sets of exercises. And your outcome is actually your goal for the 10 pounds. Does that make sense?
Yeah. And I think that's really important, because a lot of us as entrepreneurs, we'll get focused on this top line goal without doing that reverse engineering piece that you just really, and that's really what it is. It's reverse engineering. In order to achieve this thing, I need to do these little things. And those little things are those smaller bite-sized progress goals that you can take hold of, right?
Yeah, we call it your lagging indicators and leading indicators. And lagging would be like the 10 pounds. We get there, we reach that particular goal or outcome. If you don't measure the leading indicators to ensure you're going to get there, people end up at the end of a quarter, end of a year, sometimes end of a lifetime, and don't achieve what they want to achieve. So measuring those small things on a shorter term, that's why I started with every day, what's the thing that I can go do so that I can reach my goal at the end of the week, end of the month, end of the quarter, end of the year, end of the lifetime.
Yeah, and you know, when you talk about that, there's something that, you know, anybody that's had a conversation with you, Andy, knows one of your goals, or one of your goals is sort of there everywhere. You sign off your emails with plus 10 KHB, right?
Right.
What does that mean?
Yeah, that's our purpose. So we operate on a one page plan inside of the Petra programming, and you know, our core purpose is have a positive impact on 10,000 human beings every year. And we measure that as we go. We have some formulas that we discount some people. We get a room full of 50 people and we're talking to them, we discount about 20%. But we do keep up with that metric, and we're out there every day to work to do that.
So, because that's a lofty purpose, right?
It is, and it's the thing that gives us energy. You know, when we get letters and cards and emails and feedback, it's the positive personal impact that we have on people through business planning and business goal setting, but they end up taking it home and talking to their kids or doing something personally with it that really impacts their lives. That's what we're really after. That's where our heavy energy and drive and reason to go get out of bed in the morning comes from.
That's awesome. So that was the first half of the paper napkin wisdom. You were talking about where's the focus. And I know this sort of,
right,
sort of dovetails really nicely into the second half of what you sent me. And on the bottom half of that napkin, you wrote something else, and what that was is a formula. In brackets, you have P plus C, close brackets, times CE equals done. And
right.
What does that mean? I mean, this looks like algebra.
So it's P is for people. So in an organization, you got to get the people right. And if you can add that to a strong culture, and then if you can multiply that by consistent execution. The consistent execution is the piece that really, really is hard to do. If you can do those three things and do it very well, then, you know, you get things done. We actually do a talk called, I guess I can say this on there, How to Prioritize, Focus, and Get Shit Done. And this formula is what we talk about quite a bit. But it starts with the people. You got to find the A players. If everybody's familiar with the top grading program and finding those A players, one of the questions we ask a lot is, how much time do you spend in an interview process before you make a job offer? And I'm always surprised, I guess I'm not surprised, because I used to do the same thing in my business before I changed to the top grading program. The answers we would get would be like, we have an hour and a half, 2 hours, maybe 3 hours. And this is one of the most important decisions that you're going to make in your organization. These people can come in and totally destroy your business in 3 months. And you're spending an hour and a half, 2 hours, 3 hours with them. We wrote an article recently, and we talked about this particular point. And I said in the article, and it was in the paper, and I said, you are going to elect to share a toilet seat with this person for a long, long time in your office, and you're only going to spend 3 hours with them. You better get to know them a little bit better.
That's awesome.
So you got to spend that time with these folks to ensure that you don't let those C players and B players get into your organization. And if you get those A players in your organization, you better figure out ways to keep them. So they're not going to work with other people that aren't A players very long. So you got to exit those that don't fit very well. Make sure you're keeping the ones that are really, really A players. Give them training, give them growth. Pay attention to them. Make sure you give them appreciation. And then create a process so that you bring only A players in the door. So it's kind of the people side. There's a lot of functionality, other things that you can do. But in an organization, getting the people comes first.
That's great. Okay, so in the formula, it's P plus C, right? So you're adding culture to people. What does that mean?
So, you know, having an organization just full of people doesn't count very much. You got to build a culture around that. And the culture can be by design or by default. Every business has one, regardless of whether it was designed or it just happened on its own. It's going to be there. And you want to build one that's going to grow people and be a part of, a positive outcome in an organization. But we talked a little bit about long-range planning, all the way down to short-range KPIs and priorities. And we feel that building a culture around that, using that as a tool inside of the culture is very important. It's Rockefeller Habits and, daily huddles and the one-page plan. That in itself is part of culture. It also gives people good alignment so that they know what's going on in the organization. And Jack Daly has this kind of saying that he's famous for. He says, pay attention to the important and not the urgent, and that we mostly pay attention to the urgent at the expense of the important. That's a piece of culture in my old company, NationLink. Mm-hmm. We had a saying, a mantra that said, do the big things first. And we went around and said that all the time. Do the big things first. Do the big things first. It became a cultural thing. People just knew, don't get bogged down in the little stuff that doesn't really matter very much. Do the big things first. And then delegation is another big key for culture. People have to be okay with delegation, handing work off to other folks. And sometimes they're going to fail. They're not going to do it as well as you would do it. Nobody ever will. Sometimes they'll do it better. But you got to be okay with that and letting people fail. That's how they're going to learn. So creating a culture around those kind of key pieces can be very, very helpful in business.
Yeah. Even on that delegation part, for me, the culture in our company and the core values around a world dial, right? So drive, impact, approach, and leadership. And we don't use the word delegation anymore here. We've decided to just change it to empowerment because that better describes what we're doing. We're empowering with someone. And when someone's empowered, they can make a mistake because they own it. So they own fixing the mistake and learning from the mistake as well.
I love that you changed the words. I think words have a lot of power. You say we don't use delegation, we use empowerment because it has a different meaning. And I think organizations can learn from that as well, changing words. I was working with a call center recently in the answering service, and it kind of has this cultural mantra behind it with call center and answering service, and they didn't want to be known as that. So we said we're going to eliminate those two words. We're never, ever in these walls going to utter those words again. We're going to call it intake. So changing words inside of an organization, as you found, can be very, very powerful.
Yeah. No, I mean, thoughts become things, right? And if we can choose good ones, we're going to align ourselves in a better direction. So we've added culture and this all sounds very intentional, right? Andy, this is not accidental. This is not stuff that you just randomly allow happen. As entrepreneurs and leaders in our businesses, these are things that we need to build in and structure.
It's that default design thing, and you designed it, and you got to go pay attention to it. And it is an incredibly difficult, long road to go. I ran my company for 18 years, sold it January 7th at 4:38 in the afternoon, 2011, one of the best days I've had in a very, very long time. I ran it for 7 or 8 years, just crazy with my hair on fire and not very well. And I, like you, went through BOG or EMP, and then on the other side, learned these practices and principles, and took me about 3 years to get them implemented, and I was a different person on the other side. So it does take time. It takes a lot of effort, a lot of energy, a lot of consistent execution, but the outcomes are unbelievable.
And the outcomes that you're talking about as an entrepreneur and leader extend way beyond just your company for you.
Yeah. I tell people all the time, your company cannot be great unless it can be great without you. And somebody said that to me one time, and I thought, well, hell, I can't leave my company for a night or it'll fall apart. I have to be there. And I started from that moment, and after EMP, building it so that I could get away from it. You know, at first it was a week, and then it was 2 weeks, and then it was 3 weeks, and then it was 4 weeks. And just systematically looking toward that, because I knew it can't be great if I have to be there.
And really, I mean, I think it's one of the things that you talked about too was that the company should be serving the owner's objectives ultimately.
Well, yeah, that's why you started it.
Yeah.
We start those things for you know, a few very specific reasons. Part of long-term planning is some of that. You got to figure out what those reasons are so that you can actually get them in the end. That was where I kind of got sideways, is I didn't really know where I was going until I sat down and planned it. And once I planned it, I could see it. And once I could see it, I could go get it.
Okay. So, and that, so that sort of leads into this multiplication factor. So why are you adding people in culture and then multiplying it by consistent execution? You know, in the formula, why is that a multiplier?
Because it just drives everything so much faster. When you get to consistent execution across an organization, not just one or two people consistently executing, but everybody consistently executing, you know, like you said, it's the multiplier is what happened. I watched it in my own organization. We started out as we were in the wireless telecom business, and one of our metrics was we wanted to have 2 times the gross profit per FTE of the industry. And using a lot of these principles and ideas, heavily looking at consistent execution across the group, and we ended up at 4 times that number. And that's an incredibly powerful thing. It allows you to do that because you can consistently execute. You can do more with less. But in order to do that, you got to control some stuff too, because especially now with all the interruption stuff that we have, Facebook and email hell. Email is one of the biggest evils we have today. Notifications popping up everywhere, your phone going ding, somebody walking in your office. I mean, there's distractions at every corner. So controlling that time and controlling the ability to actually execute on anything is highly important.
Yeah. And that's part of that consist. You're putting the controlling of time and this limiting of interruptions under ingredients for consistent execution.
Yeah. I mean, you can go after execution all you want to, but if you're, you know, burying an email at 400 emails a day and you feel like you have to look at and respond to every one of those within 24 hours or 2 hours, some people think they can't, you know, they have to have that pop up on their Outlook. No. Why do you have to? I mean, that's not the most important thing. You know, it's stealing your time from what's really important in your business once you define what those things are. So those things are, we have to be able to control our time. If we don't control it, somebody's going to control it for us.
Okay. So what about this? You know, there's another point that you wanted to bring up under consistent execution, and that was stopping the meeting madness.
Yeah. So I recently read a book, and it talked about meetings and the waste of time, and there were some metrics in there of the study that they had done, all hours and dollars wasted in meetings. And the first thing it said was just to stop meeting, just don't meet. To really ask yourself, why do we really need to have that particular meeting? Just don't meet. And to look in your organization and start calling out 50% of the meetings. How are we going to stop 50%? Do we really need to have that particular meeting? Many meetings are just a report or a catch-up, where meetings should be spent in solving actual challenges. So finding ways to stop the reporting side of it and to increase the solving challenging side of any meeting that you're going to have. A few of the things that we work through are make sure that when you walk into any meeting, you have an outcome in mind and everybody knows what it is. So why are we here? What's the outcome of this 30 minutes, 1 hour, 4 hour, 2 day retreat, whatever it may be? But make sure that there's an outcome, that everybody doesn't just walk into the room to figure out what the outcome is going to be. The other one would be to be prepared. So any kind of pre-work that somebody can do prior to coming to the meeting would be awesome. There's probably some reporting that you can get on the table prior that catches everybody up before you hop into a room. And then Cameron Harrell talks about the no agenda, no attendant. I love that. Make sure that you have an agenda. When I heard him say that, I went right back to my old company and implemented that. It was your ticket out. If you didn't have an agenda, you didn't have to go. That was your ticket to say no to that meeting. So I love that one.
That's great. And so, you know, I think another person that I spoke with shared this notion that strategy, and you know, you probably know him, Eric Kalis out of Philadelphia.
Yeah.
So Eric says strategy before tactics, and he talks about meetings over strategy are the most important meetings that he has within a company. Does that line in with this in terms of those are meetings worth having?
Well, again, it's the meetings is solving something, right, as opposed to just reporting where we are and what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
And we should be able to do that without having to get everybody in a room. And then, you know, thinking through the fourth option or how we can do something differently, as opposed to just tactically, Steve, you take this little piece and Joe, you take that little piece.
Yeah, I think it's powerful. I think a lot of people get caught up on those kinds of things. But part of the rhythm for this in terms of maintaining this, and you alluded to it earlier on, was this notion of a daily huddle, right? You huddle briefly.
Yeah, the daily huddle.
So how does that help to make all of this possible?
So that it does two things, in my opinion. It gives you alignment across the organization so people know what's going on where, and it brings accountability to a group. So the huddle consists of kind of a what's up or what's going on. And I hear all the time, well, I've got salespeople on one side and I've got operations on the other side. And, you know, salespeople don't want to know what's going on in operations, and operations don't want to know what's going on in sales. But at the same time, we've got these two siloed organizations pointing their finger at each other all the time. And this, again, is about alignment. If we want an organization to get aligned, let's get them together, at least in a huddle, and communicating just a little bit more. So huddle's a really good spot to bring those teams together with, you know, quick what's going on, what's up. Talking about your key metrics, those KPIs we talked about, reporting on these. So that's kind of the accountability side. If I'm reporting on I'm supposed to go to the gym 4 hours this week. I only went 2 hours. I'm 2 of 4 hours in the gym. It's Friday. Everybody knows I didn't go to the gym like I said I was going to. So that's an accountability tool. And then you talk about priorities for the day and any stucks or needs that you may have. So again, alignment and accountability are the two keys inside of the huddle.
And yeah, I'm of the belief that 90% of the problems that exist in an organization, once you've nailed the people and you've developed culture, but 90% of the problems can be solved with the daily huddle.
And it goes a long way. The coaching that we do around the Rockefeller Habits with companies, you know, we'll have people say 3 or 4 or 5 months in, they'll say, if we don't learn anything else, if we don't keep anything, let's not lose the huddle. The most important thing we got out of this. It's
pretty
powerful.
Yeah, they really are. Now, what about the pushback? I mean, the pushback on a huddle is, I mean, sometimes it's just so hard to get everybody together because, you know, I own a retail shop and, you know, when are we going to close to do this? I've got customers in the store. It's impossible. How do they do daily huddles?
Well, you know, we hear. We've heard all every excuse. If it's important, you find a way. If it's not, you find an excuse. Essentially, is what it boils down to. If you want to figure out how to make it work, you'll figure out how to make it work. We do have some tools to make it easier. We have an online huddle system inside of our software where you don't physically have to be present. So if you have to be absent, you can still have your information reported, and you can go back in and review afterwards what was reported in the huddle. So there are ways to do it, but we hear that. For every huddle that happens, there's 50 that fail because somebody thought they couldn't do it.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's also one of those things, as you know, you have it. It's like a, you know, 30 days of hell but past the 31st day, it sticks. It's working out, right?
Yeah, really, and really it starts to take a life of its own after that time. It feels like effort for a while, and now people are legitimately disappointed if they're not in-house on a particular day for a huddle. You know, sometimes people will be out of the office for whatever reason, and they're always, hey, what happened at huddle? Where are we on this? And that's one of their first questions, and I think it's really powerful for us. And we've
they go on vacation. Go on vacation and come back. Oh, I missed this huddle.
Yeah, we share a quote at the end of every huddle. Somebody different brings up a quote, or someone says, hey, who's got a quote? And they'll put up a hand. And we keep a log of all of them because people want to go back and read them and find out who brought them up and why and talk about them. So it becomes like almost our water cooler conversation is past huddles, which is kind of neat.
That is really cool.
And
I'm going to steal that one.
Yeah, it was unexpected, totally unexpected. Well, I mean, that's the most that's part of this, right? You said you're going to steal this thing, and that's the best R&D for an entrepreneur: rip off and duplicate.
That's right. Rip off and duplicate. That's right.
So
save some time.
Yeah. So you know, let's put the whole thing together. So you put both of these things on the napkin for me today, and I'm going to ask you why. Why was this message important for you to communicate to me?
So I think the focus side of this is the thing that we entrepreneurs, as well as just the general population, I have two kids, 13, 15, they're both girls, and just their ability to focus during the day, TV, friends, texting, fun, all that crap, and we all have this stuff around us that's just sucking up our time and energy, and for us to really have the ability to focus. You know, 80% of our results comes from 20% of our efforts. And that's just ridiculous. We should be able to move that 20% up and up and up so that our results increase as well. And then from an organizational standpoint, this is individual, but from an organizational standpoint, it's that people plus culture times consistent execution in order to move everybody else and the organization forward faster.
You know, the critic that's listening to this will say, hey, you know, my business is more of an art than a science. How can you be so formulaic about it?
Law firms, CPA firms, financial firms, manufacturing businesses, you know, I've got sheet metal companies, we've got software. I mean, there's not an area of business that we haven't been in some form or fashion in just the last 3 years. And I'm just talking about, you know, me and our little coaching company. You know, I've seen this thing work in any organization. I can't imagine if it's got people in it, that this systematic approach to this execution stuff works.
Yeah, I believe
it. If you think it won't work, if you think it don't work, it's not going to work, it's not going to work.
Yeah, no, I believe in it firmly. I mean, I think that as an entrepreneur and a leader, we need to promote and build a heartbeat to the company, and we are responsible for maintaining that pulse is regular, and then beating that drum around these things is one of the most, if not the most important responsibility we have within the organization.
I totally agree, and The flip side of that is you can't bring it to the group and then not do it yourself.
Yeah, very true. Otherwise it gets to get blown apart. I mean, if we're not going to buy in, then why would our leaders follow? Why would our followers come along line, right?
They won't. It'll just be one more thing, you know. And we see that from time to time, too. And groups will say, yeah, we want to do this, and you figure out 90 days in that the leaders just aren't going to be a part of it, and it's not going to work. And they have the that's why it's called leader. You got to lead.
That's right. Anything as a final thought you want to share with me today, Andy?
I think all of this stuff, whether it becomes from focus, just looking and finding ways to eliminate distractions and focus on what's important, all the way down to looking for the right people, A players, and removing C players from organizations and building an organization around those A player teams and creating a culture that is built on this consistent execution format. All of it comes down to if you can design that thing out in the future and say, this is what I want it to look like, it's much easier to see. You know, the saying is we get what we can see, but we can't see it until we actually design it. So do it by design. Don't let it happen on its own. You may not like what you got. And if you don't like what you got, change it. You know, design it, look at it, and go get it.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Andy, thank you so much for joining me today. I love talking to you, and you're always blowing my brain up with thoughts and ideas. Any chance that I can bring you again back here in the future?
Absolutely.
That was a great chat. You know, I think that one of the things that I resisted pretty strongly when I was starting in business is that there were formulas to this. I thought, you know, entrepreneurs had this artistic sense for what a business was doing, and it was in flow and in flux, and I resisted this notion of focus, that I needed to focus on any one particular thing, because, you know, I could juggle a lot of things, and, you know, I think that's one of the things about entrepreneurs, we really can. We can handle, we have this capacity to juggle a lot of balls. Leaders can do that, juggle a lot of balls. But if we really want to make progress, focusing on things is really important. And this notion of WTF is significant and important to me. I'm distracted even now by bright and shiny objects. And I think that it's this reminder around where my focus is on a daily basis intentionally that has helped me in recent months cope with challenges. Also, the formula that he talks around people and culture and consistency and execution is true and is reaping results for me. So I hope that the paper napkin wisdom has value to you. I know it's been hugely impactful to me, this particular message. If you want to join in the conversation, you can do so at www.papernapkinwisdom.com. Also, you can find us on Twitter at Wise Napkin. My name is Govind Jayaraman, and this was Paper Napkin Wisdom. Thanks for listening.